Anupriya. For those who are new, we have a, if you want to join our mailing list, we have a registration form at the reception desk. So after the lecture, you could leave your email address and phone number if you wish to. So today's topic is Yogi life in modern times. Whenever we think about yogis or meditators, somehow it always brings about the picture of a forest for me. That, you know, somebody is a sage kind of, or a serene kind of person, meditating in a forest, in a reclusive kind of environment, and away from this world and things like that. But the Raj Yoga way of meditation is very, very conducive to meditation here, right here. We all have jobs to do, families to take care of, and we just thought that it would be very nice if we can learn from long-time yogis here, and we are very privileged to have two very distinguished panelists here today with us. You can see just one, the second one is invisible currently, but she'll join us soon. So we will hear from them and how they are sort of leading this life since so many years. And maybe towards the end of the session, we can also, if you have questions, then we can take them up also. So maybe we can start with Jose, who will tell us, who will introduce himself also, and also tell us. Oh, you're here.
She's right here, okay.
Okay. Yeah, so Jose can tell us about your journey of how you became a yogi and about yourself.
My name is Jose, and I've been practicing meditation here in this center for about 13 plus years, and I never thought I would be become a meditator. I never thought that this would be something that I wanted to practice. But a friend of mine came into my way, right? And so I used to read a lot of spiritual books, self-help books, and she asked me if I wanted to learn meditation. So, well, that would be interesting. So how do I go about with that? So then she told me about this subject. So I took the courage. So
which one is that?
So I took the courage to come here, and I met one of the sisters here in the center. So in the beginning I was a little shy. I didn't know if I want to start this new thing. But then I said, so let me try. If it's not for me, then I just don't go back. But then I like the way they spoke. I like the practice that the way they taught me how to practice this Raj Yoga. And it's called Raj Yoga. And one of the first, one of the things that I learned was that this Raj Yoga meditation is practiced with open eyes. So I thought to myself, myself, so how am I going to do that? But then I stayed. So then the teachings were very interesting. Taught me of who I am, which I didn't know. All my life I was thinking that I was just this flesh and bones. And I knew about a soul, but I never really think about it. And it is as if I don't know nothing about the soul. So I learned that there is a spiritual being, an invisible being inside, that is the one that makes all the decisions in life. And I learned that's the real being, that's the eternal being. I learned that this body is just an instrument. But at that time, I was still thinking about it. I still a little incredulous. I didn't want to believe first. But then I started to practice. And I kept coming and coming. And the more I heard about these teachings, the more I got into it. And another thing was that many of the things that we go through, situations, difficulties, it's because we are concentrated, we are more connected to the physical world, to the things outside. But then there was this thought that if you concentrate more, if you go more deep inside you and start recognizing yourself as a spiritual being and start practicing, all those things will disappear. If all those thoughts of worries, those negative thoughts, that's another thing. And I can learn to have more control over my mind. And that I thought it was very interesting. And so since then I started to practice that. And then there has been a lot of experiences, a lot of learning. I'm still learning. I learn from situations. I learn from others who are practicing the same thing. And so that kept me going. That kept me coming. And the more I learned, the more I wanted to be here, the more I wanted to practice. So that's the start of this journey.
Thank you, Brother.
I really like the way you used courage, the word courage, to come here for the first time, and that is probably very important for all of us. You know, there may be intention, but then it does take some amount of courage to actually go about doing what you really intend to do. And personally, the feeling is that if one were to leave everything and go to the Catskill Mountains to meditate, that is not really courageous, isn't it? But to live here and then, like he was talking, to live here but still not think about those things too much, to be connected to the inner being, makes all the difference. So thank you for that sharing. Maro, would you want to also share your journey and introduce yourself?
Say that you have to respond. Om Shanti.
Om Shanti.
That makes us feel like a family now. And that's the first thing I had to come to grips with. The word Om Shanti. And when I say Om Shanti to you, I am not recognizing your color, your religion. I'm recognizing your identity, that you are a peaceful soul. So I'm saluting that divinity within you. My journey is a very strange one. For some it may seem complicated. I have been in Gyan for as long as many of you are, as old as many of you are. I'm trying to figure my age out now. And it started so many years ago. I was already a family person. I had a family, I had a husband, I had children. I had a job when Gyan came to me. And I was sitting at my desk, because like I said, I had one. And this sister, have you ever looked at Sister Rhoda very well? Is she familiar? She has on a white sari, isn't that so? When a lady looking just like her, shorter than her, came into the office, my desk was just at the door. It's like 15 people. Did I not think I have a strange story? Okay. And she said, God has sent me for you. And I thought she's talking to someone, but she's looking at me. And her accent was very, very deep. I couldn't understand. But then she repeats herself again. Those are strange words for a stranger to come and tell you. And then she invited me to a program, something of this nature. And you want me to be honest, I didn't turn up. And then she came back 2 weeks after. She invited me to another program. You know where that lady came from? Where that sister came from? From India. To Guyana, where I took up my bar. And so after the second invitation, I went to the center, which I have to pass every day on my way to work. But at that time, it's only Indians. So if I'm in a black body going through that door, that gate, everybody wants to live something is gone. Can I not tell you I have a strange story? And so what I used to do, they have morning class, but I wait until the morning class is over, and then I will step in, and the sister there will give me the essence of the morning. And then I start to practice. Then I realize I'm a soul. Not only a soul, but a peaceful soul. Now you know if you're working 15 people, you've got to have challenges, right? And then I start, it's not as easy as now, it is very difficult as to say that you've got to go from soul to God to cycle, and you hear about that as you come. But every piece of knowledge I got, I start to apply it to my very life. What do you think was the hardest part to do? Getting up in the morning. Amrit Vela, you know that was very easy, isn't it? But I start to practice that. Getting up a little earlier and staying in remembrance. What do you think is the other difficult thing? I had a family, did I not say that?
Actually, her daughter sitting right there.
Oh. I was a meat eater. Chicken and... You know what I'm talking about?
Everyone knows.
You know what I'm talking about?
Hamburger.
Uh-huh.
Hamburger.
Hamburger. And some chicken wings, right? So I had to look at the family, having fun with all of that, because I'm practicing now, I'm applying. Can you imagine that? And then I had to start using my own pot, because you can't cook. And my own cup, and my own everything. I didn't walk away from my family, because you know when you come, you will hear detachment. But what I do, I practice every day to see them as God's children. And then that same soul that Sister Rona pointed out to you just now, when I went and I told her about detachment, she said, well, I can't understand all these years you're coming in and you're loving us up and you're kissing us up, and now we can't have that. But what was interesting, my Lokic or biological husband is in Gyan too. So all of you who are coming here, and you may have another partner, you just simply do what is taught here, just simply apply it. Don't push them. And eventually God will call them to Him. Application to what is taught is so very necessary. And then you will realize that there in you change is taking place. If you are a troublesome person, get very peaceful. Nothing anyone says will bother you. And so I, the soul, have journeyed for a number of years. And I have found such benefit in practicing, getting up in the morning, in meditation. What do you think is a good time to start? That's the time you should start. But if you can't start at 4 o'clock, what you do?
6 o'clock.
6? No, that's a little too late. That's a little too late. Everybody is up by then. And that's one thing I used to do, always get rise up before the family. Yeah. So what you think?
Four thirty?
All right, well, you also get, but you must get up at 4:30 every day. And then what's the next thing?
Go to bed earlier.
Well, yes. So if you have things to do, you know, you may be up late. But then you have friends and they will want to take you out for a dinner or a lunch. Or what do you say then to them? What do you say? And your family, who you're accustomed to cooking anything for her. You can still eat with them, but your meal is different. Dear, look at you as if something is going on here. But they are benefits. And the third thing is that you start to watch your thoughts, what you think, what you speak. When you start with that tree, it's so important, everything else will fall into place. I've only given you the introduction of the book. That's enough for now, right?
Thank you for such beautiful sharing, and we can already see the transformation from when you entered the first time her center and when you, today when you introduced yourself as not seeing the color or the race, and it was so beautiful. And also the fact that the practical aspects of, you know, when there is a change in the lifestyle, then we face obstacles in a way, or, you know, our friends may ask us for certain things, like meeting them, having dinner with them, and there's a change in lifestyle, getting up in the morning. These are very practical, you know, things which where what she was trying to say is that determination is really, really key to success in this kind of a lifestyle that we have. So thank you for such beautiful sharing. Maybe Jose can now tell us, what is your idea about a modern yogi, you know, because we all have ideas about yogis. But what is your idea about a modern yogi?
But you say that in India there were sages that they used to go to the mountains to practice yoga. They wanted to go away from society. They wanted to they leave their family, they leave society, they leave their friends, and then go to the mountains where they are by themselves, so nothing around them, and they can concentrate, and they can achieve that concentration in the self, but only to a certain point. I think a modern yogi is one who can manage concentration amidst all things that's happening here right now in the world, especially in this city, New York. When we can draw our attention away from this, all these happenings in society, all these happenings with our friends and families, which whatever someone, especially the family, if they're going through some situations that are not very pleasant, even though I am not going through it, that will distract me from my own concentration and will create some feelings and emotions that I don't want to experience. So all my attentions will be towards those who are close to me. And if we manage to concentrate even though those things are happening, in practice, this practice of meditation, whatever it is that someone practices, to whatever kind of meditation they practice, and be detached from all situations going on around us, and keep practicing and not letting anything pull me away from it. Don't letting anything dishearten my, making me dishearten and stop practicing. That is a modern yogi. And also, one, when you achieve concentration of the self, when you achieve a mind that is calm and quiet, and when you can create thoughts, positive thoughts, thoughts that make you feel good about yourself, and others who are around you can feel good as well, that is a modern yogi. And also a modern yogi is one who pulls others to what you are doing, to what you do, towards what you are practicing. And when they start doing what you are doing, you can say that you are a yogi and modern.
To tell us your idea about a modern yogi.
Okay, I'm not going to say Om Shanti again because I know that you know that now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But I really didn't get into that question very well.
Uh-huh.
But if we're talking about yogi, it means that we have to have yoga. And you know how many of us have yoga with Fifth Avenue? Right? I've been there, I know. What do you think? How many of us have yoga with Seventh Avenue? I understand that the Lord and Taylor is not there anymore, right? How many of us have yoga, which means remembrance or union with Macy's? What do you think? But I don't need to go further. If you look at the soul that is sitting, that God has put to run the center where we are now. Have you ever looked at her and her grace? The way she walks, the way she talks. I'm talking about Sister Rona. Mm-hmm. So you don't need to have yoga outside talking about Sister Rona. What do you think? Have you ever had an interaction with her? No? I mean, talking with her? She's sharing something with you? No? Can you look at Sister Rona as a senior and instrument of this center? Have you seen her radiance, her grace? You see how she's shining? Look at her. You have permission to look now.
I have now.
Sister, we want to know about you. You're
not sure.
And why I'm saying that, right, is that she is a teacher that can that shows us what a modern yogi is. As long as you have, because we think that a more modern yogi is, or to be in the world, of course, in the physical world. But now we are changing to yogi. It's a beautiful thing when you understand, like I understand, the soul understand now. Because the world has nothing to offer, and I'm a yogi that is walking the pathway. then for me to really and truly live in this world, I have to have yoga with God only. I don't need to go anyplace. I can sit anywhere and have yoga. And that means, just remember, remember who God is. Remember who you are. And as long as I stay in that consciousness, no matter what's going on in the world, I can deal with it. I'm not distracted. Regardless of what the world out there is saying, you know, there's temptation out there with the clothes we wear and what else. And you are tempted, or we can be attracted to those side scenes. But with this knowledge I have learned, as long as my yoga is with God, as long as I'm remembering God, it is so important, as my Father, as the light, as a teacher, long as my yoga is with God, I will show the radiance like Sister Rona, still going back there. And if you meet Sister Mohini and all the seniors, they're so radiant. They're so angelic. Because they are living that yogi life. They don't need to have a special clothes to put on. All they need to do, as I am learning from them as my teachers, that my yoga must be with God and God only. What you think? See why you have to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning? Because if you don't get up and strengthen that mind and intellect, then the yoga go haywire. So I do that every morning, try to get up, have that meditation, build my yoga. During the day, try to keep that yoga. And then I know, regardless what's the fashion out there, I'm radiating something that the whole world wants. Om Shanti.
It was so beautiful that both the sharings about modern yogi touched upon this aspect of being able to withdraw from whatever surroundings we may be in. So Marva spoke about Fifth Avenue and Macy's, and you know, but to be able to see but not see in a way, right? And to be connected. Not to Macy's, but inside, right? So it doesn't mean that I don't go to Macy's, because there are things that I need to buy from Macy's, but I'm not thinking about it all the time, you know? So that ability to withdraw and have, in a way, not tempted by Macy's, but I do what I am supposed to do still, in a way, develop that disinterest, not in the way of, again, you know, not caring about or not wearing good clothes or whatever, you know, but still leading a good life, but in a different way, not pulled by it.
You should also answer those questions.
So, thank you for that sharing. And now maybe a bit more practical aspects about, you know, we are surrounded by noise,
activity, and we have so many things to do. We are so busy, you know, in today's world. What are some practical things or what are the practices that you do to transcend, make that transition from doing to really being? So maybe Marva wants to start this time.
You know, your life is in your hand. How many of you know that? Your life is in your hand. And I realize that where I am living here, in this human world, is a world of talking. We all have one, right? I have mine here too.
At least one.
Right? Because we live in a talking world. So we think that our only means of communication is through talking. Rachel has taught me to explore. I can choose to be in this talky world. Or I can choose to be in a world, even though my eyes are open, I can see things. And I can choose to be in a world. Check ourselves. Check myself. You know, I have a phone. Sometimes when I pick it up in the day, in the night, I don't even hear it ring in the day. But in the night, I go to charge it and I say I have 25 calls or messages. I live in a talky world. I know that. And sometimes you need to communicate. And communicate through word. But we are trapped in this talk world, you know that? Some of us don't know how to shut up. How to give this moment some rest. You know, I say that to her so often. Because all these meetings on the phone, I said, when you go to sleep, I can imagine your mouth is saying, oh, thank you for the rest. We have to check and see which world we are living in, and that's what I do. How much time I spend in this talky world, on the cell phone, and please, I understand that the system is so set up that you now have to use phone and everything. But what about when you don't have to use it, and you're still on it? I use a subway. You know what I'm talking about, right? But you don't have to use it. Leave it alone. And you can take that trip like I do. And peace. You don't even want to talk no more. Because it is such a good feeling. It is such a refreshing feeling. So the world is pulling me to do. 24 hours, do. The demand is there. But even when I'm doing, I can still be. As you go on, you will find out that you have two subtle faculties that is called the mind and the intellect. Very trapped in this world. But I move them away and find that peace, find that being, remembering who I am, remembering I have a home, that's a place of peace, remembering that I have a father who is the ocean of peace, and so I be. I find time to be amidst the demands of the world. You can still find time to be yourself, and that is Om Shanti. You get that? What does it mean? What does Om Shanti mean? Remind yourself that that's what you are, and find that peace that is really your identity.
So, just one comment on what you were sharing. It's such a good reminder that you reminded us that the option is ours to be peaceful. The choice is ours to be peaceful. It is up to us whether we want to connect to that peace or not. And it is revolutionary. This is a very simple statement, you know, the choice. But then if we practice and if we exercise that choice, it is very, very powerful. So thank you for reminding us. And now we'll hear from Jose about some practices.
One of my practices is when you're always around someone, somebody is talking to you, or somebody is doing something. So my practice is not to see what they are doing or what they are saying. Because yes, they are right in front of me, they're doing something, saying something, and I'm listening, but I am not taking that inside. How do I have, what do I mean that I am not taking inside? I am not creating any type of thought about what they're doing or saying. Same things with situations, what goes on in the news, what goes on TV or Facebook, whatever, which is very, that everybody is on the cell phone most of the time. So I don't put my attention there. I start to create thoughts of the self. And one of the thoughts that I usually do is that I am a peaceful soul, a peaceful being, different from the body. And what helps me tolerate what others are doing or saying or whatever it is, that they are also a peace, that they are also soul, they are also, their nature is peace. And if they're acting in such ways, it's because they don't know. And I think to myself, I know, but they don't know. And that gives me, that creates tolerance and patience with others. So you start to have patience for others and for things that if they don't happen the way you want them to happen, it's because it was not meant to happen, because it's telling me that I have to move on to something else, to something new, instead of me start creating negative thoughts or wasteful thoughts about situation. Because when that happens, when thoughts arise that they are negative or wasteful, it drains my energy out. And I lose that practice, I lose that consciousness of who I am. And then that energy drains out. And then when I go home, what happens? I feel tired, and then I don't know. Which I was not doing any physical activity. Why am I tired? Because the energy, we accumulate energy by our positive thoughts. Not only by using our physical body to do heavy work, the energy drains out. It happens mostly the way we think. It happens in the mind. What are my thoughts? What kind of thoughts I have in the mind? It is draining my energy out. It's making me feel in a way that I don't want to feel or I don't want to experience. So I transform those thoughts. I change. I don't think about others for what they are doing or what they are saying. But I see their real self that they are. And also I have these feelings that creates this good vibration towards them that they can catch, that they can even change. And speaking about changing, another thing is that I usually think about is that I cannot change anybody, I cannot change any situation that happens. So why going into the depth of things when I don't have the power to do anything for other things or other people, but for myself. So I concentrated in myself, what can I do for myself? So today I learned something. I learned that most of the time we think about our good quality to maintain good concentration. I have to think of the soul, I have to think of my good qualities. And all that, but I learned that if I want to change, I have to think about my weaknesses. Because when I think about my weaknesses, I can realize that I have weaknesses and that I have to do something to transform or to change them. If I don't think about them, then nothing will be done and they will never disappear. They will always be there. And so, because of my weaknesses, I will react in the wrong way towards others, other people, and situations. But if I think about them, then I can rectify those weaknesses and also my mistakes and not doing them again. Okay?
You spoke about not creating negative thoughts and, you know, even looking at your weaknesses. Just want to know, like, how do you do, like, practically, if somebody, say, at workplace is criticizing you or saying something not very nice about your work or whatever, is there a time, because I've seen you over the past year or so that I've known you, I've never seen him get angry about anything, you know. So what is it that, you know, if it were to happen at workplace or something like that, if somebody, what do you do to, what kind of thoughts, you did mention that to think about them as soul, you cannot change. But then at that point of time, what do you really do? Do you react? Do you say something? Do you stay silent? even if you say stay silent, are there thoughts going on in your mind? How are you so peaceful all the time?
When they criticize me about my job or anything, I just agree with them and tell them this, and I'll do better the next time. That's the only
thing. No, but if you did a very good job and still they were criticizing you, then...
Well, I know what I did, I know it's a good job. If somebody is not happy about it, it's because they're not happy with themselves.
That's the magical formula, now we know it.
No, and at that time, you cannot tell them anything because they will not listen to you. So you wait for the right moment to speak to them and share with them what something that they can use for themselves.
Okay. So we know the secret now, thank you. Okay, so our sister Amarva, you were mentioning earlier about some of the obstacles that come along the way. So, you know, do you think it is really easy to be a yogi in modern times, or it's difficult? And if there are some, you know, practical tips which you can give us to overcome problems and obstacles.
Obstacles, and I understand why obstacles are there. Again, it starts with me. Because the things that is going on in the world, you may not want to accept it, but you're a part of it because it's coming out somewhere from you. And that's where Raja Yoga comes into play. I don't know if I'm jumping the gun, but I had one of the biggest obstacles. I don't know how many of you may have shared something of this kind, right? Like I said at the beginning, I had a family when I came in again. And I wasn't again for some time, and I lost one of the souls, one of the children, in an accident. Did you hear me? Isn't that a very big obstacle that you think you can't remove it? Right? What brought me through? I noticed that the rest of the family was falling apart. I've come from a very big family. The rest of the family was falling apart. But because of the knowledge that I have in the Raja Yoga, what kept me going is that I bring to mind that he was a soul. Spent a certain amount of years with the family. His time with the family is over. And so he must move on. So that was a very big obstacle. Not a sightseeing that you can pass it by. It's something that came into your life, into your family's life. But because of the knowledge that the soul is eternal, that the soul is immortal, soul is everlasting. Another thing is, even if it's another soul that brings in front of my life or in my world some form of obstacle or some sightseeing, cherish or remember, whatever part that soul has played, that's the part the soul came to play. I may not like it. But it is what it is. The sightseeing will come. But we can't get trapped into it. For me, the biggest sightseeing or the biggest experience I ever lived was losing a child. But the knowledge of Raj Yoga, I remember, it's a soul, an eternal soul, moving from one existence to another. And that brought me through. And anyone that is playing a game of distraction, again, I want to say this, because we interact with people every day. But regardless, you may not like the part that they are playing. But let us remember, as I do, that's the part that they have to play. So I'm not going to get into the game of how they play their part. So the first question is, I have to be me. Understand that this is a soul, and the soul is playing its part out. Come, Shanti.
The usage of words that was there during the sharing, sight, scenes, game, for a kind of situation in life which generally would be termed as tragedy or trauma or something like that, it just shows that you're an embodiment of an easy yogi, you know, the ease with which the whole situation is related also. It's really inspirational, actually. Thank you. Would you want to also tell us what keeps you going on this path? I'm sure there are lots of difficulties on the path. Maybe you can tell us more about the difficulties from your perspective, and then what keeps you going.
I think difficulties, if there is no difficulties, I will not become strong in what I am doing, which is in becoming a yogi. A yogi which, like Sister Marva explained, yoga means connection. So to whom do I connect to? First, I have yoga with myself. So I connect with myself. I connect with the eternal being inside, which is the soul. I learned what are the qualities of the soul, what the virtues, what are those qualities, which are qualities of peace, love, happiness. And when I connect with the self, then I start contemplating on those qualities. And I start being peaceful. I start being loving with others. I start to be happy and maintain those feelings inside. Maintain that awareness. And then I go further. Then the soul has to connect to something. If the soul has to connect to the source of that love and peace and happiness, which is the Supreme Soul. And the Supreme Soul is the is the eternal, is my eternal father. And saying that he's my father, that means that I get an inheritance from him because I am his child. And what is his property is love, peace, happiness, wisdom, and spiritual power. And when I am connected to that being, I draw all those qualities in myself. And I might maintain that connection, and I keep that awareness of who I am. And being in that awareness, Sister Rona usually talk about everything happening in the world as a cartoon show. So I have to see things as a cartoon show.
That's my favorite too.
So not giving importance to whatever is going on. Because if I give importance to something, then my yoga is not with the soul and the supreme soul anymore. Then I connect to situations and I connect to other people. And that's why I see situations as obstacles.
So like Tom trying to hit Jerry with a hammer. Right?
Yes. Because when we see a cartoon show, you know things are happening, but you know nothing happens to those little cartoons. You don't feel sorrow for them. You laugh. So what happens in this world with others, with ourselves, we take things too serious because we are thinking about the physical. But when we think about the soul, when we know, realize that the soul is eternal, nothing can happen to the soul, then you start to see everything as a cartoon show.
Yeah, thank you. Maybe we will end with 5-minute meditation of each, both of you. But maybe we take questions first, if you have any questions, and then both of them can guide us 5 minutes of meditation each. Is there anything anybody wants to ask? Yeah. Yes.
Thank you for that beautiful sharing. In my practice as a yogi, which is in its fairly nascent stages, one of the challenges or obstacles or situations I face is that I find it difficult to balance when should I let it go or not chase or not attempt to work on what I see is unjust or if there is unfairness being practiced in front of me at my workplace or in my peer group or otherwise. And when to actually engage with that, fully knowing that this may entail a lot of struggle. So if you have any suggestions for that.
I don't know if this is the right answer, but what I usually do if something unjust is going on in front of me, I am not the one who is doing it, and if it's not affecting me, I should not be putting too much attention to that. Whoever is doing something wrong, that person will have to answer for that. And I don't have to go around with why people are doing that. Like one of the things I learned, I cannot control anybody. Sometimes we try to control people, and what we do is make things worse. So things start escalating and escalating. And without us knowing, we find ourselves in a big situation that we don't have control at all, not even to think about it.
Yeah, sure.
I hear you, and thank you for sharing that. But what if you're put in a position where you're leading or you're representing a group of people, and part of your job is actually to see what is affecting people around you? What do you do then?
I think I go, you have to follow rules, right? And you have to follow what you are told to do at the job. Something that is not, you didn't put it in place. Let's say your company or whatever group you're with, somebody, you got together and put rules in place that they have to follow. And guidelines. If I follow those guidelines, then I will be free of worry.
For me, did I not ask that what time do I have to get up in the morning? That's the answer to all, even if you are in the corporate world. As you get up and you do your meditation, then send that energy, that vibration to your place of work. Because the world is filled with peaceless souls. But it does not change the fact that they are your brother souls. And you may be in a position that you have to, you're ahead of it all. And of course you have to follow the company's guideline. But if you are filled soul consciousness, it's not what you say, it's how you say it, and it can still be very effective, because you still have to look out for you, right? The company is expecting you to carry out the rules, but it's not what you say. You will get when you are in yoga.
I just want to end with one line. Somebody very nicely brought out the difference between, you know, one who does yoga or who tries to meditate. What is the difference between somebody who's doing and a yogi? So did you get the difference that somebody who does yoga and a yogi? So somebody who's doing yoga is living here in the physical world and trying to meditate or trying to connect to the world beyond, whereas a yogi, he lives in that world beyond and he sees the play as a play, the game as a game, the physical as totally separate. So that, in a way, nicely summarizes what we were trying to tell you with the help of our panelists. I think it came across. So thank you to both of you, and we'll end with meditation, some experiments with meditation. Both of you, 5 minutes each. So we know what to do tomorrow morning and the day after as well.
Okay, everyone relax. And just relax your feet, your legs, relax your thigh, your stomach, relax your arms, your shoulders, your face. And bring your attention to the middle of the forehead. In between the eyes, visualize the point of light, the soul. I am the soul sitting in the forehead. I am peaceful. And I merge all these eternal qualities of the soul, the eternal being, my peace, my love, and happiness, and as I think of this quality in itself, I share them with other beings. All these qualities, start touching others. Whenever I approach, they start experiencing being peaceful being. A being full of love and happiness.
As I sit in this stillness, I ask myself, who am I? I am a soul. What is a soul? Soul is a point of light. Peaceful. is here. I speak to myself. But I am not this. I am a being of light in this body. With this understanding, light fills this body. Anything that is not of the sun now melts away. I sit in this consciousness of beingness, of who I am. I begin to feel good about myself. I begin to love myself. I begin to be myself. As I return to the consciousness, I am the soul, I'm in a body. I look at all human beings, and I see them as my brother soul.
One announcement for those who are interested in doing the next step. We do have Thursday talks every Thursday. But for the meditation course, we have the next meditation course starting 11th May, which is a Saturday. It will be for two Saturdays, on the 11th and the 18th of May. So whoever wants to come for that, most welcome. It'll be in the morning from 10:30 or 11.
It's there on the calendar.
And Wednesday, there is a Spanish program.
Yeah, there is a Spanish program also on Wednesday, first of May, in the evening.
Okay.
Oh, it's flowers. Don't you want that in your home?